Listening Library presents The Long Ride by Marina Budhos. Read for you by Nieme Camara. In memory of my mother, Shirley Zaltzman Budhos. Queens, New York City, 1971. Prologue. Boots. It's a hot June afternoon, 3 days before sixth grade graduation. My two best friends, Francesca and Josie, are sitting with me in Francesca's bedroom, chatting about the new junior high all the way across Queens. Francesca's room is the nicest. She has a spiraling rattan headboard, a shag rug, and matching beanbag chair. We're already munching on our favorite snack, cheese doodles dipped in cream cheese. Why do we have to go so far? Josie asks, sipping a ginger ale. Integration, I say. I test the word in my mouth. What's that mean? Josie asks. Everyone will look more like us, Francesca says. We've always been different from the other kids in our neighborhood. Our skin, nut brown and coppery and dark brown. In the class pictures, we're the smudges that somehow stand out or make a grandmother's smile go stiff. Oh, that's nice. Where's she from? Francesca is unusual pretty. Gray-green eyes like her mother's, set in a tawny face. Frizzy gold-brown hair with a hint of kink. She shifts around in her looks like a tabby cat. And then there's her full mouth and a body that seems much older than mine. Sometimes when we page through our magazines and giggle, I think, I can see Francesca there one day. It's going to be so great, Francesca says now. We're going to be so popular. Josie makes a face. I don't care about that. Josie's the quiet one of us. She does her hair in two tight braids, wears old-fashioned dresses, her thin gold cross dangling over Peter Pan collars. Watch. I jump from the bed and strut, draping a towel over my hair and pretending to toss it over my shoulders. Oh, hi. Sorry, I can't hang out. I'm so busy. Francesca and Josie fall over laughing. I know what we have to do, Francesca says. We have to wear the same boots. Oh, yeah, like the song. When we were little, I used to play Nancy Sinatra's These Boots Are Made for Walkin', and I'd prance around in my own shiny go-go boots. Only let's get this kind. Francesca pulls out an issue of Tiger Beat. In the picture, two girls are standing back to back, arms crossed, bandanas tied around their necks, and wearing orange construction boots. We'll wear them the first day. Promise? Francesca asks. We make our vow. Me and Josie and Francesca will wear the same orange construction boots. We'll stand at the bus stop and put together our toes so they make a three-petal flower. Then we'll march into our new school where there will be more kids who look like us. We convince our parents that we want to buy matching boots for our 12th birthdays. Francesca and me are in August and Josie is in September. We have to do it before Francesca leaves for England to see her grandparents, as she does every year. At Thompson's shoe store, we find the exact style. Orange tie-up construction boots, a seam of white stitching like tiny rice around the rim. We each slip them on. Make sure they have enough room, Josie's mother says. Your girls are growing. She took us down here since we're not allowed to go on public buses by ourselves yet. I like the feel of these boots. The stiff leather, strong and sturdy. I'm sure I can march anywhere. We bump hips. Here we come! Francesca shouts in the middle of the store. Hush! Josie says, but I can see she's pleased. When we step outside with our packages, the muggy air hits us. The Jamaica Avenue L train shrieks overhead, making slashing shadows of dark and light. We're so happy with our new boots, we skip the whole way to the bus stop. We are ready. Part 1. Chapter 1. We the Dream. 12 is the best and 12 is the worst. It's the breathless swoop at the top of the Ferris wheel, dangling and wishing you could stay. It's the moment when the wheel's about to drop and you're scared, but it's thrilling too. Because 12 is when you clutch for everything to stay the same. But it's also when you're tipped forward, ready for something new. In the spring of sixth grade, our last year in elementary school, Francesca and Josie and me like to lean against the schoolyard fence and stare at the kids in front of the junior high across the street. Girls with long straight hair that swings at their butts. That's going to be us. But how will I ever get from here to there? I still play with Josie's dollhouse. I'm afraid of the dark. I sort of giggle about boys, but really, I wish they'd leave us alone. When I think about 13 and having a chest that shows beneath my shirt, my stomach hurts. I wish I could stay right here, fingers on the diamonds of twisted metal, looking out. Almost 12 is when I learn about our new school. When everything changes in Queens and in New York City. One day I come home with a mimeographed flyer.
What's this?
My mother starts reading. Her light brown hair is drawn back into a ponytail. Daddy always says that Mom still looks like the 20-year-old he met studying at a coffee shop near Columbia University.
It's called a pairing.
What's that mean?
The seventh graders will go to another school, a new one, in South Jamaica.
Why on earth? Our junior high is just a few blocks away.
Integration. Mom looks at Daddy standing in the door. He nods.
Integration.
Integration. That's a good thing.
One of those banner words that snaps brightly over our heads. Last year, we did a dance about Martin Luther King Jr. in the gymnasium. All the girls in maroon danskins. We listened to the I Have a Dream speech crackling on speakers.
My four little children will one day live in a nation where they will not be judged by the color of their skin.
Integration is what our family does in quiet and private ways. Mom grew up on Long Island, the daughter of a policeman. She met Daddy when she was studying social work, and he was an engineering student living in Harlem. When her brother, Joe, heard she was dating a man from Barbados, he showed up at her apartment, tapping a crowbar against his palm. Daddy gently invited him to eat keema that he'd cooked for Mom. Uncle Joe laughs now, says that he had to like a guy who cooked for his sister. Still, no one in the family came when they got married at City Hall. Two nights after getting the flyer, Daddy and Mom go to the school meeting, Mom with her cardigan draped over her shoulders and a pleated skirt. Daddy in his usual suit and tie. My parents always get dressed up. One of Mom's many rules for me and my brother Kareem, you have to give a certain kind of impression because they're not used to families like us. Meaning a tall black man with a hint of East Indian in his face and his pale, thin wife. I'm finishing my homework when they come back, arguing softly in the living room about the new plan.
It's not that bad, my mother says. Penny, I didn't work so hard to get myself out of a village school for my daughter to go to school in a poor neighborhood. That's going backward.
It's all new teachers, Mom says. A new building.
But why now?
Our schools are as segregated as ever. He sighs.
I know. But have you ever driven by those streets? The boarded up windows?
He shakes his head.
My child is not an experiment. If those words came out of our neighbors, you'd be upset. There's a difference.
Is there? He doesn't answer. Me and Josie and Francesca, our families, we're a link of firsts. No one ever says that exactly. Francesca's mom, Mrs. George, who has strawberry blonde hair and high cheekbones and was once a model, often boasts.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.